Hey, it's John, an enduring charm. I'm outside here looking at some masonry steps to a porch. You can hear the landscapers in the background doing their thing, and you can tell from the pumpkin here that it's late autumn and we're running out of time to do something with this. So the problem here may not be obvious at first, but you start looking closer and you can see some issues. There's cracking here, and this is kind of a parge coat or facade. This has been repaired before for sure. And I start looking closer here, like there's some cracks here. But most concerning, if I look at this line right here, there's quite a bit of cracking there. And this is a problem in this area because you get a freeze-thaw cycle, meaning in the winter time, what happens is water or moisture gets into this masonry, and then maybe during the day it's warmer and the water melts and gets in there. And then at night, it freezes, or the temperature drops and it freezes, and when that water expands, it blows apart the masonry. This is a common problem in the Northeast where I live. So you can see evidence of previous repairs here, which is fine. It's something you have to keep on top of. And sometimes it gets bad enough where you can't really fix it anymore without doing major surgery. In other words, removing all these bricks, setting up forms, pouring new concrete, that kind of thing. But I think here we are going to be able to do some patching and repairs and at least give it a few more years. I look on this side over here, I'll try to get a camera in here. You could see here, you know, some of this has come off. And I think that's a previous parge coat. A parge coat is just like a surface coating of mortar. So, you know, it's come apart. Again, freeze-thaw cycle. It blew apart probably last winter or the winter before. And this is what you see. So I think we can fix this. One thing you have to be very cautious of, and I want to mention this right up front, these bricks, you can think of them as French bread in the sense that they have a hard outer crust and a soft inner bread, if you will. And you want to make sure you don't damage these bricks on the outside, because if you nick this, or at least cut through it, water will more easily get into that internal area, and that soft internal area will blow apart very easily. So you have to be very careful. So what we're going to do here is remove some of this mortar here in these joints, and we're going to repoint those joints. Now I can use a diamond wheel grinder to do that if I'm very careful, again, not to nick these bricks. I can also just chip it out by hand, you know, with a chisel and a hammer, and I may do a little bit of both. For these areas like this where, you know, some of this is coming off, I'll see what I need to do here. You know, some of this may come off easily, some may not. I gotta look at that. Again, over here, I'll be whacking this with a chisel and a hammer and see how much loose stuff comes off. But anything loose we want to get rid of so that we can make a new surface. Now I want to make sure I get all of this, so I do need to remove these pavers here. They're also brick, but they're pavers. These pavers, I need to remove a section of it so I can get down below the surface here. And same thing on the sides here. I'm going to need to pull back some of that dirt so that I can get access. As I'm getting started here, I just noticed this. This is a brick that has blown apart from the freeze-thaw cycle. And that spalting there where it just blows apart. Water got in there, you know, it turned to ice when the temperature dropped and just expanded and blew this apart. So we're going to have to look at some things like this and maybe seal these bricks. That's something we'll talk about. So I think what we're going to do today is take our tools here, the grinding wheel, the hammer, chisel, and just some basic tools here and chip away anything loose. Clean it all up and then see where we are. All right, as I'm chipping the surface away here, you see me once in a while just tap, and I'm just listening for hollow sounds. Because if it sounds hollow, it means it's not well adhered. And, you know, this is really not in great shape. There's an argument to be made that this is done and it's time to redo the whole thing. But, you know, I think we can probably repair this and get a few more years out of it. We'll just make sure the homeowner understands what they're getting into. But when I see stuff like this, so there's the surface, and this has been repaired too. So there's pieces that come off in the surface like this, and that's not a big deal. I mean, that's just on the surface. But when I get deeper in here, it's kind of crumbly. It's almost like rot. It's like masonry rot, if you want to think of it that way. And when it gets all crumbly like this, it's not a great surface to adhere something else to. So all I can really do is clean this out as best I can, get all the crumbly loose stuff out, and this, I mean, it just comes down to dust almost, and get as much of that out as I can. And then when we come back here and apply a new mortar to the surface, you know, how well it adheres, it's questionable, honestly. All right, I used a wire wheel to help clean up the surface, and I just swept things down just to see where we are. So look, it's not great, honestly. This is concerning here. So like I said, this is not going to be a long-term repair. If we get a couple more, three years out of it maybe, at that point, it's going to be time to redo these bricks, take the bricks totally off, maybe pour a form, or maybe redo the whole thing. Because there's only so much life you're going to get out of this when you start patching like this. But we got most of it done. I see a couple areas that I missed. I'm going to go back and work out like this joint right here I didn't finish, and a couple more. So not too bad. If you see the joint here, this is between the slab that was poured and the brick. You know, I got to clean that out, make sure it's nice and clean, because when we have the new mortar going in, we want, you know, we don't want any debris in there that's going to prevent it from sticking to both sides there. So I will end up cleaning this with a hose, getting all the dust and dirt off that I can. When we do the parge coat here, I want to just, any dirt down here, that's not good. We want to just make sure we get all that off that we can. And then when we repoint these joints right here, again, I want to make sure they're totally cleaned out, nothing going on there. So a little more cleaning to do. The wind is picking up, which is not great for this because I don't want the mortar to dry out faster than it needs to, but it is what it is. So let me get this cleaned up, and then we can start talking about patching and repairing. All right, I spent a little bit of time getting this cleaned up with soapy water and a bristle brush, just getting the worst of it off, and we're in pretty good shape. The more I clean up, the more I notice things like this, a cracked brick right in the middle here. So as I said earlier, this is definitely on borrowed time. All right, I'm just going to be using a Type S mortar to do these repairs. Sometimes I'll put an acrylic fortifier in. In this case, I'm not going to bother. It's really not going to buy me anything. And along the same lines, there are products you can buy to apply to this surface to essentially promote adhesion by the mortar. And I have used those from time to time, but in this case, I'm not going to use it because I know in some areas I'm going to have a very thin parge coat. So it's going to be something like a 16th of an inch, almost nothing there. And when you have it that thin, those products that help promote adhesion, it's just too much water or moisture in there, and it's not going to help at all, actually. So I'm just going to avoid that for this. All right, let's talk about tools that we'll need. I have a couple trowels here. I don't want big trowels because I'm working in very small spaces. And I have this flat trowel, which I will use for the parging. I have a spoon here, which helps you when you repoint those brick joints. There's two sizes here. There's a 3/8 and a 1/2 inch, and it helps you tool the joint so that you make a nice, you know, little indentation there in the joint and pack in that mortar. I also have a bristle brush and an old sponge with a rough side here. You can use these to texture the parge coat after it's kind of set up a little bit. You may or may not want to, it depends. But if you leave tool marks, and sometimes you have no choice but to leave tool marks, you can use these to kind of blend in those tool marks and make a more uniform surface. Now to mix the mortar, I'm just going to use a bucket this time. Ordinarily, I might use a tray and a hoe, but I really don't have much to mix up, and it's just going to be easier to just use a bucket, and then I can add a little bit at a time as I need it. Now let me just point out, as I'm going along here, this is the joint that we're worried about, and I've tooled that, but you can see on either side there's debris left over, extra mortar left over, which looks messy. And we're going to take care of that two different ways. One, as this starts to cure and set up, as I keep going, I can come back here with a wire brush and just clean up the edges a little bit. But then after everything is completely cured, I can come back here with an acid and clean all that extra stuff off, and it'll look perfect. So don't freak out about that. Just understand it's something you have to deal with a little bit later. Thank you. All right, that's the worst of it done. And now I have to wait. I want to put a texture on here, remember, and smooth out all those tool marks. And I can do that, but I need to let that set up a little bit. Otherwise, it's just going to peel right off. So while I'm waiting for that, and while I'm waiting for some of these joints to set up a little more, I could take my trowel and just clean out all this mess that I made here and make sure I can put these bricks back, the pavers back, without any problem. So I'll clean that out. And then as that is cleaned out, I'll take my wire brush and just start working on the bricks a little bit, not on the joints, but aside, you know, on the side of the joints, just clean it up a little bit. But again, it doesn't have to be perfect. We're going to take care of most of that later. All right, after brushing things off and just tooling those joints one more time, that's what we've got. And this extra stuff here, when that dries, we're going to use an acid to get that off. Or you could leave it. Some people just leave it, but probably I'll just use an acid to get it off. And then I am going to try to seal this. Now, I don't have a lot of options right now because of the supply chain issues. So there's one sealer I could get. Never tried it before, but we're going to give it a shot. And really the point of that is mostly the bricks themselves. And I feel if I can get some sealer on there, help keep some of the water out or the moisture out, the freeze-thaw cycle won't be quite as bad. Now in the areas where we did the parge coat, I just did a quick pass with a brush, and that's a little rough yet. But once that sets up a little bit more, it's going to take probably a couple hours at least. I could take a wet sponge with this rough edge out, and I could just go in a circular motion with the sponge with some water on it, and that'll just smooth that out and leave a nice swirl finish on it, and that'll be nice. Okay, it's the next morning and this is starting to dry, firm up, looks pretty good. Now you see all this extra mortar that's just left over on the brick. Some people actually like that look and they leave it, but we're going to try to clean it up a little bit. Now this right here is muriatic acid or hydrochloric acid, and it's nasty stuff. So if you're going to use this, it comes in various different concentrations, so you got to look at the label. You're going to use gloves, eye protection, and you're going to mix it with some water. And when we use it, what we're going to do is wet down the whole area first with a hose. Then with the mix, I'm going to use a bristle brush, put some of the muriatic acid on the bricks I'm trying to clean up. Use a bristle brush just quickly, only a few seconds usually. It'll bubble up a little bit, that's normal. And then I'm going to hose it down, and that's it. You just want to neutralize it as quick as you can. Now, if you have nearby plants, it can hurt the plants. In this case, yeah, I think they're pretty far away. I think it'll be all right. I'm not going to use a whole lot of it. So I'm just going to wet this whole area down. You'll watch me do it. But like I said, if you're going to be using this stuff, it's no joke. Make sure you take personal protection with the gloves and the eyes especially. Thank you. Okay, after cleaning the mortar off with that muriatic acid, I put the pavers back in place and I rake the dirt back where it's supposed to be. Now everything is still wet and it certainly hasn't cured yet. So once this dries and cures, the color will become much lighter. Instead of this dark gray here, it'll be something more like this over here. So we just have to wait for that to happen and probably take a day or two. Now there's one last thing I want to do, which is to add some waterproofing. I'm not endorsing this brand, it just happens to be the only thing I could buy right now. But if I put something for protection on these bricks especially, that will help as far as the freeze-thaw cycle. If I can prevent water or moisture from getting into the brick in the first place, then when it freezes, it won't blow the bricks out, which has been some of what has been happening. But this repair should be, you know, maybe another 2 or 3 years of performance, I hope. And after that, it's anybody's guess. I think it probably will come to the point where, you know, this whole thing has to be rebuilt. But for now, this will do the trick, and that's how you do it.